the filthiest people alive. To me, bad taste is what entertainment is all about. If someone vomits watching one of my films, it's like getting a standing ovation. I've always tried to please and satisfy an audience that thinks they've seen everything. I try to force them to laugh at their own ability to still be shocked by something. This reaction has always been the reason I make movies. I hate message movies and pride myself on the fact that my work has no socially redeeming value. I like to think I make American comedies. Pink Flamingos is a very American film. It was billed as an exercise in poor taste, and I like the understatement. It deals with very American subjects, competition and war, and concerns two groups of outcasts vying for the title the filthiest people alive. On one side, we have Divine, the queen of sleaze, and her troubled family. Crackers, her demented hillbilly hippie son, played by Danny Mills. Cotton, her bleach blonde, glamorous, and voyeuristic traveling companion, played by Mary Vivian Pierce. And Mama Edie, Edith Massey, a 250-pound senior citizen who sits in a playpen dressed in a girdle and bra and worships eggs. The challengers to the title are Connie and Raymond Marble, Mink Stoll and David Lockery, a jealous, publicity-hungry couple with pre-punk red and blue hair who sell heroin to inner-city elementary school students and kidnap hitchhiking girls, impregnate them with their servant's semen, and sell the babies to lesbian couples. The Divine family is trying to live quietly, knowing that they are indeed the filthiest people alive. But the Marbles attempt to seize this title by sending them a turd in the mail and burning their trailer to the ground. Provoked to war, the Divine entourage kidnaps the Marbles, puts them on trial for assholism, and murders them at a press conference called for the sleaziest newspapers in the country. Divine eats shit to reiterate her claim to this title and moves her family to another location, Boise, Idaho, to once again try to live a peaceful life of filth. Vincent Perenio, the art director for all my films, understands perfectly the shabby look I love. We began searching for the ideal trailer, but only had $100 to spend, which severely limited the selection. We finally located one we could afford, a mere shell of a mobile home that had been burned to a crisp in a fire. A good friend, Bob Adams, known in Baltimore as the Psychedelic Pig, lived in a commune of draft dodgers, drug dealers, and homosexuals in a decaying country mansion and gave me permission to build the trailer set on the property, back in the woods, away from the prying eyes of his rather snooty neighbors. Vince went to work on it immediately. The walls and ceiling were restored, sometimes only with cardboard, but once the charcoal gray and pink paint went on, who could tell? Every lousy thrift shop and white trash furniture showroom was thoroughly searched for their ugliest items. Leopard skin contact paper and a God bless our mobile home wall plaque completed the trashy interior. A blue gazing ball and a few pink flamingo statues placed on the lawn added to the perfect setting for the home of the filthiest people alive. For the home of the Marbles, the villains of the film, I decided to use my own house exactly the way it was. A normal row house on the outermost boundaries of the nicest neighborhood in Baltimore, it faced a semi-ghetto neighborhood, and I knew the neighbors already thought we were crazy, so they could be counted on to ignore us once the filming began. Making a color, feature-length costume drama on $10,000 proved a near impossibility. Fred, the man who was hired to supply the camera and sound equipment, had cold feet right from the start. The cast was friendly, but seemed to make Fred nervous, especially Divine. Watching her in a revealing dress rehearsing the line, "I'm all dressed up and ready to fall in love," made Fred pale beyond belief. Edith Massey, my favorite character actress, played Mama Edie, the retarded egg worshiper. She too seemed to unnerve Fred. Because of the freezing weather and Edie's scanty costume of girdle and bra, assistants would wrap her in blankets between takes, realizing that even her ample flesh was not sufficient protection from the cold. One especially freezing day, Edith would give Fred a coy smile, giggle, and whine in her wonderfully nasal voice, "Oh, Fred, could you rub my feet?" Fred blanched, but how could he gracefully say no? Fred's concerned wife started showing up uninvited on the set, nosing around, nagging him to quit, and acting as if she had just stumbled upon Mi Lai. She glanced nervously at the knives and guns the actors fondly caressed in their roles and broke into a cold sweat when she heard lines such as, "We have your address, you know. We might be in the mood for a barbecue. Get what I mean? A human barbecue." The more perplexed and angry I became at Fred's insufficient technical expertise, the more horrified he became at the scenes he felt he was being forced to witness. I think he forgot that movies are only make-believe. In one scene, Divine and her family are horrified to receive a turd in the mail. Divine, always the professional, had shit in the box the night before and gift-wrapped it, unselfishly easing the workload of the prop department. Fred did a double take when he heard us discussing it, and for the first time, openly clucked in distaste. "Oh my God, someone has sent me a bowel movement," Divine shrieked as he opened the gift in a perfect one-take shot. Fred began gagging, which really rubbed me the wrong way. Did he think his shit didn't stink? Maybe if we had been on schedule, we could have had time to keep it on ice or something. But no, due to his camera, which kept freezing and eating the film like there was no tomorrow, we were constantly behind schedule. Where the hell did he think he was anyway? Hollywood? Fred's days on the set were numbered. The chicken fuck scene seemed to be the final straw for Fred. Even my cult audiences think this scene was a little much. To this day, I can't figure out the fuss. Two characters in the film, Danny Mills and Cookie Muller, are having fake sex with a live chicken between their bodies. Somehow, the chicken's head gets cut off, and not surprisingly, the chicken dies. Before you run off to report me to the ASPCA, let me inform you that the cast cooked and ate the same chicken immediately after the filming, therefore making it, well, politically correct. Didn't Fred eat chicken? Don't most of the people who are horrified at this scene eat chicken? How do they think it gets to their plate? Chickens don't have heart attacks, for Christ's sake. I got this chicken at a freshly killed poultry store, so actually I gave it a reprieve from death row. Not only did the chicken get fucked, so to speak, it also got famous in a movie to boot. We actually made this chicken's life better. After all, animals are born to be eaten. That's the natural order of things. I would never want to eat any food that didn't give up its life for me. Fred's moral objections to the script and his broken-down camera finally proved too much for me. He couldn't have been happier when he was told he was fired. No matter how bizarre the script seemed, the filming itself was quite conventional. Nothing was improvised, no one threw a star fit, everyone was always on time, and the cast and technical crew, after Fred, seemed to get along well. Some audiences seemed to think the actors were actually just playing themselves, a great compliment, but ridiculous. We would all be in jail or mental institutions if this were true. No dope or liquor was allowed on the set, even though I heard in later years that some of the cast would sneak a joint or inhale a little cleaning fluid behind my back. Everyone involved was deadly serious about making Pink Flamingos. We were a dedicated group, over-anxious and driven to share our trashy vision with the world. The big day had arrived. Divine picked up the dog shit and put it in his mouth. He chewed it, flicked it off his teeth with his tongue, gagged slightly, and gave a shit-eating grin to the camera. Presto, cinema history. A first and a last in the annals of exploitation, and a finale to one of the cheapest feature-length films ever made. It was hardly an improvised scene. Divine and I had been planning it for over a year. "Would you eat some dog shit for real in the next film?" I had asked Divine. "Sure," he said, without missing a beat as he nibbled a donut and lit what must have been his 50th joint of the day. It was the first scene I had thought up for Pink Flamingos. I knew I only had $10,000 to work with, so I figured I had to give the audience something no other studio would dare give them, even with multi-million-dollar budgets. Something to leave them gagging in the aisles. Something they could never forget. It couldn't be fake. It had to be one continuous shot, turd to mouth, so to speak. No cutaway reaction shot to give me a chance to replace the real shit with some special effects ripoff. No siree. You'd see the dog shit, he'd pick it up and eat it right before your very eyes. My audience demanded as much. I realized filmgoers would have trouble believing it even without a cut. No actor could be that dedicated to cinema, quote, art, unquote, to eat dog shit, dressed in drag, solely for the audience's amusement and entertainment. But no one realized what a trooper Divine really was. We fed the dog continuously for 3 days without letting it out for a walk. The dog's name was Nazzy, and I had been told by its owner, Pat Moran, my longtime assistant director, that the dog was not exactly shit-shy. I loaded the camera as Divine shaved off the last stubble from his chest and strapped on his fake tits. He struggled into his cheater, a rather moldy fake pubic area, as Van Smith, the makeup genius and ugly expert, painted on the last of the elaborate and startling eye makeup. He touched up Divine's lipstick, realizing the focal point of the upcoming scene. Divine wedged his ample body into the skin-tight dress and placed the hideous yellow wig on top of his nearly bald head. He slipped into his battered gold springolators and paused to reflect on his shocking image in the mirror. "I'm ready," he said, as he vainly tried to conjure up some motivation for this big scene. We hit the streets. Present were Divine, myself, Mary Vivian Pierce, and Danny Mills, and an extra to walk the dog. No one said a word. We let the dog choose its own course around downtown Baltimore. Shoppers and passerbys glared at Divine in horror, but we bravely ignored them, concentrating only on the big take. Little did the shoppers realize how lucky they were to be confronted only with Divine's bizarre appearance. Divine was ready to dive down and eat the shit whenever the dog was ready, and would have done it even if strangers had been passing by. But no, the dog was being temperamental. I guess it realized it was now a film star. This can sometimes bring on obnoxious attitudes. Every once in a while it would stop, nose around, and piss, and we would let out a collective moan. This went on for nearly an hour, and I was losing light and beginning to panic. Someone suggested an enema, and an assistant came up with a hair dye applicator bottle filled with warm water. The dog wasn't thrilled, but luckily this was a non-union movie, so it didn't have much of a choice. With this rather unpleasant task completed, we continued our silent vigil. Finally, the moment of truth. The camera was running and the dog lifted its leg and a rather disappointing turd fell out. "Go!" I yelled. "That little one," Divine moaned, not looking forward to a second take. "Yes, God, action!" I screamed, practically collapsing as I looked through the viewfinder of my camera and heard the film noisily rushing past the shutter. As Divine dove down and began munching, Danny and Mary Vivian started laughing so uncontrollably they had to turn their heads and run from the scene. I was shaking so much that I worried that the handheld camera shots would be even worse than usual. "Give me a shit-eating grin," I begged. Divine smiled lasciviously and gagged twice. "Cut!" I finally yelled to the much-relieved star. I rushed over and gave him a congratulatory kiss, but I'm not sure if it was on the lips. "Now I know I'm insane," declared Divine flatly as he spit out the last of the shit and made a mad dash for some mouthwash. I staggered back to my car, ecstatic. I had gotten the most difficult shot and finally finished the film. 1 month over schedule and $2,000 over budget. That night at the wrap party, the cast and crew sat around drinking beer and laughing about the day's big scene. I think you can get sick from eating shit, piped in some smart aleck. Divine, out of drag and makeup, seemed to pale noticeably at the suggestion and grabbed the phone to call the emergency ward of the local hospital. Assuming the voice of a suburban housewife, he tried tactfully to pose the question to the confused nurse on the other end. "Yes, my son ate some dog feces, and I'm wondering if he can get sick." From Divine's annoyed expression, we could tell the nurse was starting to ask nosy questions. Well, you see, he's sort of retarded," Divine tried to explain. The whole room exploded in laughter, but Divine silenced us with a hostile glare. I see, thank you," said a visibly distraught Divine as he hung up the phone. "She said he'll probably be okay, but it's a possibility he could get the white worm." "White worm?" the cast yelled out in hysterical disbelief as Divine melodramatically grabbed his gut. For months afterward, Divine had an hysterical case of the white worm, but he survived this mysterious parasite without even a single day of bad health. Was this day magic? Maybe so. Even though I think I've directed and written much funnier scenes, and Divine has given much better performances, this particular image, conceived as a negative publicity stunt, is more famous than anything I've ever done. For 15 years, Divine has been trying to live it down. And for 15 years, I've been trying to live up to it. Even though Pink Flamingos has a self-imposed X rating, it is hardly a sex movie. The Raincoat Brigade always stomps out of the theater when they discover the X is for hideousness rather than dirtiness. Children love the film because to them, sex is always ludicrous. There's a 69 shrimp toe-sucking scene, rape by forced artificial insemination, and exhibitionism with a turkey neck tied to a penis. But the missionary position is never once shown. I would never want to film hardcore pornography, because it always looks like open-heart surgery to me. One scene, I guess you could call erotic, especially if you're a chubby chaser, features Divine sashaying down a crowded Baltimore street in the dead of winter, dressed only in a clinging cocktail dress and full makeup. None of the real-life shoppers realized a film was being shot because the hidden camera silently tracked Divine from a moving car. All they saw was a huge, scantily dressed woman, oblivious to the weather, undulating her way down the street with the confidence of a fashion model on a runway. Blowing kisses and smiling to dumbfounded strangers, Divine was unveiling his look for the world to see. Heads swirled and people did double takes. We left a cop on the corner totally agape. When the crowd would start screaming and laughing and seemed on the verge of a disturbance, Divine would leap into the car, we'd drive to another crowded, unsuspecting block, deposit him, and start the cameras rolling again. Shooting in my house always seemed like a luxury. There was central heating, adequate electrical outlets, and real bathrooms, so the cast was always relieved to hear we'd be shooting a scene at the Marbles residence. I love the idea of living on a movie set, getting up and realizing that your everyday reality is about to become someone else's fantasy is almost magical. True, there were drawbacks. For one of the scenes, all the furniture had to be ripped apart and converted into special effects furniture. Furniture that rejected you. Divine and Crackers have broken into the Marbles' house and cursed them by licking all the furniture. The Marbles return home, and every time they try to relax, the cushions fly up from the sofas and throw them to the floor. This effect was easily accomplished by ripping out all the springs and insides of the furniture and replacing them with one Vincent Perenio, the set designer, who would shove up the cushions on cue. Why Hollywood studios waste so much money on special effects is beyond me. Everyone in my neighborhood seemed most cooperative when I was searching for needed locations. I found the best way to get a location was just to walk in and boldly ask if I could film. If the people were not used to this request, they generally would stammer confused, "Well, when?" And I would tell them, "Right now." They generally said yes, thinking it would be interesting and give them something to talk about. Once they saw the actors in costumes and began to get paranoid, it was too late. We'd film immediately before they changed their minds and get out. Hit and run filmmaking. For one scene, the local post office allowed us to set up all the equipment during business hours and even volunteered the clerk on duty to play himself. I doubt whether he realized the package he was filmed receiving from David Lockery and Ming Stoll contained a turd, but he didn't seem to ask any questions. I still buy all my stamps from this branch, even though I long ago moved from this neighborhood. The doctor who lived next door was also nice. He never once mentioned the screaming rehearsals or the blood-curdling murder scenes his patients could surely hear during office hours. One night, as we rehearsed a particularly appalling scene with dialogue such as, "We impregnate the girls and sell the babies to lesbian couples," I heard a timid knock on my door. When I answered it, an ashen-faced girl was backing down the walkway, mumbling, Is this the doctor's office?" She fled before I could explain he was located right next door. The landlord came through and was nice enough to let me use his 58 Cadillac Coupe de Ville for Divine's car in the film, but I still needed a much more ostentatious vehicle for the Marbles to show their lack of understatement in the battle of filth. Divine and I were on our way to the movies to see Gina Lola Brigida in Plucked when we noticed a beautiful 59 Eldorado limousine being driven by a black man with an orange conch hairdo. We followed him, honking the horn, until he finally pulled over. Relieved we weren't plainclothes cops, he agreed to rent us his car with a stipulation that he always be present on filming days. I soon learned this was not out of concern for the care of his car, but a way to make sure he and his white girlfriend had a safe, warm place to shoot up for the day. I liked him, and I think I made him feel right at home. I even used him in a scene that was later cut. Mink is looking in the mirror, asking who is the filthiest person alive, and his face appears in all its ravaged glory, saying, you are the filthiest person alive. I never saw him again after I finished filming his limousine. Who knows, maybe he moved. With the film nearly completed, a few cast members rebelled and refused to do some scenes I had written out of fear for their lives. Looking back on it, I guess they were right, although I didn't understand their concern at the time. Cookie Muller, who always plays hard-boiled sluts in my films, refused to smash in a TV screen with a hammer while the set was turned on. She called every TV repair shop in the phone book and explained the scene, and they all told her it would explode. I thought this would be a beautiful shot, but she drew the line. The scene that was supposed to contain this shot was later cut from the film anyway, and I guess it would have been silly to take the chance. Mink Stoll had originally agreed to set her hair on fire, but got cold feet as the shooting day approached. She never seemed to want to discuss it. She was supposed to be brushing her dyed red hair, and because it was just so red, I wanted it to burst into flames. She kept asking how I planned to do this, and I sheepishly replied, "Well, I guess we'll just put lots of hairspray on it and someone will light it." I tried to explain that an assistant would be right there off camera with a bucket of water to throw on her in case the fire got out of hand, but when the day arrived to shoot the scene, she flatly refused. I think even today, Mink would have to admit that it would have been a smashing shot. One fire that did go on schedule was the burning of the entire trailer set. I had no fire trucks on hand because I knew I could never get permission to set a huge fire in the middle of the woods during a very dry winter. My token fire safety precaution was a single fire extinguisher supplied by my understandably apprehensive brother. The neighbors were notified not to be nervous if they saw smoke, since we would be burning some, well, garbage that day. David Lockery and Mink Stoll doused the entire interior of the trailer with gas as the cameras whirled. A terrified Mink lit the torch, and you can see her surprised expression in the film as her cheap costume almost catches a fire. As the fire raged out of control and the skies were filled with thick black smoke, I kept on filming, vaguely picturing the entire woods on fire with burnt squirrels and deer running out a la Bambi. Divine, Danny, and Mary Vivian bravely did their lines next to the blazing trailer before it collapsed in a burning heap of rubble. Everyone was extremely relieved, especially the owners of the property, that the trailer had burned itself out without incident, even if it did smolder for several days afterwards. Even today, nearly 17 years later, I still make occasional nostalgic pilgrimages to the trailer site. The commune has long since scattered, its own house empty and ravaged by its own fire. The mile-long path is completely overgrown, and you have to fight your way through sticker bushes, but the burned-out trailer is still there, completely camouflaged by the surrounding woods. The world premiere of Pink Flamingos was scheduled at the University of Baltimore in late 1972. Opening night was packed. Most of the stars showed up in ludicrous outfits, stoned out of their minds, extremely proud of their accomplishment, but worried sick that the audience might somehow turn hostile. Even the dog, who was about to become infamous, made a star entrance wearing a jeweled collar bought especially for the occasion. I hid in the projection room, pacing back and forth, chain-smoking cools. But as soon as the film began, I knew I had a hit. The audience roared with laughter in the right places and shrieked in horror in others. New Line agreed to take on the film. I convinced them to open it at midnight at the Elgin Theater, the most popular film buff hangout in Manhattan. The Elgin agreed to show it one night at midnight. The reaction was great, and the Elgin agreed to try it one more time the next weekend. As I nervously approached the theater the following weekend, I was thrilled to see a huge line wrapped around the block. "Hey, I think you got a hit," said a surprised distributor. Word of mouth did it all. New York Magazine started the ball rolling by calling it the nearest American film to Buñuel's Andalusian Dog, and Fran Lebowitz cinched its success by describing it as one of the sickest movies ever made and one of the funniest. The big critics had to wait in line to put it down, and even Vincent Canby panned it, not once, but twice on the front page of the New York Times Sunday Entertainment section. Variety didn't review the film for over a year, finally giving in and headlining in bold print, "Dregs of Human Perversity, Draws Weirdo Element, Monstrous." The reviewer went on to call it surely one of the most vile, stupid, and repulsive films ever made, and called the shit-eating scene the most nauseating caper in film history. My own favorite review came from the Detroit Free Press. "Like a septic tank explosion, it has to be seen to be believed." Why I love violence. I'm hardly what you'd call a mellow person. When audiences see my movies, they always seem appalled that I find such humor in the violence I lovingly depict. "How could you think of such awful things?" liberal critics always ask. "How else could I possibly amuse myself?" I always wonder. It's not that I want to harm anyone. I've never initiated physical violence in my life. But thinking about violence seems to relax me and give me comfort. Even when violence is directed at me personally, I've managed to keep a cheery attitude. Recently mugged in New York and given a serious concussion, I managed to stagger to a rather snobby friend's apartment. As she opened the door and saw me covered in blood, I'm told I blurted out, "I've just killed 5 people and I've come to involve you." Life is nothing without a good sense of humor. Even as a toddler, violence intrigued me. My parents claim they suspected something was wrong with me from the beginning, and my childhood obsession with car accidents seemed to confirm their worst fears. While other kids were out playing cowboys and Indians, I was lost in fantasies of crunching metal and people screaming for help. I would sweet-talk unsuspecting relatives into buying me toy cars. As soon as I was alone, I would rush out to my favorite place, a tree stump surrounded by mud located in an obscure section of the woods near our house. Here was my own little fantasy world, a child's version of an auto collision center. I would take 2 cars and pretend they were driving on a secluded country road until one would swerve and crash into the other. I would become quite excited and start smashing the car with a hammer, all the while shouting, "Oh my God, there's been a terrible accident!" Another childhood obsession related to violence in my mind was amusement parks. I've always loved scary rides, and to this day, I'll drive hundreds of miles to go on a roller coaster if I've read that someone has recently been killed while riding it. If I could pick my own death, it would be on a roller coaster that jumps the tracks and careens into a packed crowd at a cotton candy stand at the state fair. Also, I loved hurricanes and prayed one would hit our community. Once, one did, and I will always remember it fondly. The high winds uprooted trees in our lawn, and I sat for hours and looked lovingly at the damage. But the best sight was right up the street, where a giant tree had fallen into a neighbor's house. You could see right into their bedroom from the street, and I would sometimes take my lunch up to the corner so I could look at the damage while I ate. I remember being heartbroken when the workers finally came to make the repairs. Another thing my parents could never understand was my hatred for sports. Knowing I love violence, they incorrectly figured that sports would be a healthier outlet for my interest than my little games of destruction. But violence in sports always seemed so pointless because everyone was prepared. So what fun could it possibly be? In grade school, I was forced to participate in sports, but was always the last chosen when teams were picked. This was a relief rather than a trauma, because at least my fellow teammates accepted my attitude and didn't expect the slightest effort on my part. Happily making up weird little stories to myself, I would always be startled if the dreaded ball ended up anywhere near me and would make no attempt to catch it. My teammates would be screaming, "Waters, waters!" as the opposing team's players raced around the bases, but I never paid any attention, figuring it was their problem. The few times I was walked to a base, I panicked at actually having to be involved in the stupidity of the game and tried to make conversation with the disinterested, wildly competitive first baseman. "Did you see Dagmar on TV last night?" I'd ask, trying to be friendly. "No," he'd growl, furious that I was paying absolutely no attention to the game. "She was real good," I'd continue, forgetting that you were supposed to keep 1 foot firmly planted on the base. Suddenly, everybody started yelling like there was a national emergency, and someone threw the ball to the first baseman, and he lunged at me with it, and the umpire screamed, "Out!" "Thanks," I mumbled in all honesty as he scowled in my face, unable to comprehend my eagerness to get out of the hot sun and sit back comfortably on the bench. To this day, I'm a confirmed sports bigot, and even the mention of sports riles me uncontrollably. "How about them birds?" some ignorant cab driver will ask, referring to the Baltimore Orioles and trying to be friendly. "I hate sports," I state flatly, ending the conversation with a thud. Just because I'm a man, why does he assume that I want to talk about sports? It's as ridiculous as if I got in a cab, slapped the driver on the back, and screamed, "Hey, how about Fassbender's in the Year of the 13 Moons? Wasn't it a knockout?" Whenever I hear a friend casually mention an interest in a sporting event, I immediately reconsider our friendship. After all, I argue, sports are responsible for lowering college academic standards and ruining holidays by dominating every family get-together with a loud and obnoxious TV big game. All sports are contemptible. Basketball, freakish giants with midget IQs, dunking balls in macrame baskets that are the exact height of the players. Football, fat hogs knocking each other down and huddling to tell secrets that no one in their right mind would care to repeat. boxing, ugly, notorious, underprivileged men, beating each other up without the thrill of breaking the law, and skiing, eager beaver masochists in polyester outfits, anxious to break a leg in the name of fitness. Despite sports, I had a happy childhood. Naturally, I loved horror movies or any kind of movie that had good villains. The Wizard of Oz is still my all-time favorite movie, and even as a child, I rooted for the Wicked Witch. To hell with Dorothy. The witch had pretty green skin, a beautiful castle, and all those wonderful winged monkeys. Dorothy just had a dull home in Kansas, dreary farmer parents, and an ugly little dog that bothered the neighbors. I even tried dressing up like the witch to terrify my neighborhood friends, but succeeded only in raising a few eyebrows. As villain worship took up more and more of my time as a child, I decided to design horror houses in the family garage and charged a nickel admission. Kids would enter the pitch dark through fake spider webs and risk breaking their necks on the little traps I had set all through the maze. After selling a ticket, I'd sneak back into the horror house and wait at the exit. As annoyed customers groped their way to the door, I'd leap out and spray them with a fire extinguisher that made a horrible noise and shot forth an icy, thick smoke. Pretty soon, parents began forbidding their children to enter, and my little business was forced to close. I couldn't wait to be a teenager so I could get pimples. I craved braces for my teeth, but the uncooperative dentist insisted to my parents that I didn't need them. Undaunted, I unbent paper clips and wedged them into my gums and felt much better. When I entered junior high, I received the thrill of my life. Actual girl juvenile delinquents were in my class, and to my astonishment, they got into catfights. I immediately lost interest in the school's curriculum and concentrated completely on every move of these cheap girls. I had never seen anything like it. Dressed in black straight skirts, white angel blouses, and pointy-toed fruit boots, they hung out in packs, combing their Deborah Padgett bangs and discoloring their lips with pimple medicine. They never did their homework and were proud of it. They were only wasting time until they could legally quit school, run away, and become full-time skags. Since all my favorite girls quit school or were expelled, I started imagining fantasy ones. Instead of doing my homework, I'd draw monstrous teenage brats, give them fictitious names, and jot down autobiographical horror stories on the back of the drawings. There was Big Leslie, 15 and pregnant, charging boys quarters to feel her bra straps. Placed in the special ed section for slow learners, she eventually burned down the school. And Bobby and Betty, twins, one evil, the other good. I'd draw the same face but apply completely different hair and makeup and imagine the hell of their home life. Bobby would try to study, but Betty would punch her and force her at knife point to fill in all the wrong answers on her homework. As long as I was alone, I had a million friends. Luckily enough, I also had a career in mind. I wanted to make the trashiest motion pictures in cinema history. Baltimore, Maryland, hairdo capital of the world. I would never want to live anywhere but Baltimore. You can look far and wide, but you'll never discover a stranger city with such extreme style. It's as if every eccentric in the South decided to move north, ran out of gas in Baltimore, and decided to stay. No one moves here. It's hard to imagine a family scene where Dad comes home from work and announces, "Guess what, kids? I've been transferred to Baltimore," and they roar back in excitement, "Baltimore, yay!" No, you have to have been born here, gotten infected by Baltimore's charm, and decided to live happily ever after with this rare disease. When the city thought up slogans to lure tourists, "Baltimore is best," "Charm City, USA," everyone laughed, but I couldn't agree more with these sentiments. The Chamber of Commerce should stop trying to hide all the negative aspects of Baltimore and start playing up the seamy side to lure every crackpot in the country to this great city. Baltimoreans, or Baltimoreans as they are sometimes called, shouldn't hang their heads in shame when they hear Baltimore referred to as the armpit of the nation or Bumburg. Be proud! Think of it as Trashtown, USA, the sleaziest city on earth, the hairdo capital of the world. "Come to Baltimore and be shocked," bumper stickers should read. You can take the train, but watch your luggage as you approach Baltimore. Or take the bus, but make sure you use the restroom on board. The lavatory in the bus station is quite dangerous, And if you aren't stabbed by teenage delinquents, you may be amazed to see perverts brazenly trying to squeeze underneath the stall. They always seem to carry empty shopping bags, so if you give the okay for sex, they can stand in the bags and disguise the fact that there are two people in the booth. You can even fly into town. The airport used to be called Friendship, which I always liked, until some wise guy tried to jazz up its image by renaming it Baltimore Washington International. You can easily get a cab from the airport into the city, but another warning. Cab drivers sometimes reverse the usual procedure and pull a gun on you, steal your luggage, and lock you in the trunk. If you think you're hearing a foreign language, listen carefully, and you will be surprised to realize that it's actually English. Baltimoreese is harder to understand than Swahili. Far means fire, cake means coke, Danny-ation translates loosely as spending the summer in Ocean City, or idiomatically, down the ocean. And it seems everyone in town is named Hun. Once you get downtown, don't check into a hotel, rent an apartment. The old buildings are quite beautiful, and unless all the greedy liberals from D.C. have hogged them by now, spacious, moderately priced apartments are easy to find. Don't pay any attention to the guidebooks. They'll tell you all about the new Baltimore, the Inner Harbor, the Baltimore City Homesteading Program, the City Fair, but this is not why I choose to stay in Baltimore. It's the unbelievable people. Just go out on the streets and meet someone. It's not hard. The streets are teeming with all sorts of lunatics, quite eager to make friends. The first thing you will notice are the hairdos. Baltimore women per capita have higher hair than their counterparts in any other American city. I like to go out and look for especially exotic hairdos, much in the same way a bird watcher clutches binoculars and stalks a rare scissor-tail flycatcher. A good hairdo voyeur knows it's easy to spot barrel curls, bubbles, artichokes, and split levels, but if you really have some patience, you'll be able to come across a real rare bird, such as an authentic beehive or my all-time favorite, the airlift. The best hairdont area in Baltimore is Bel Air Road. It's made up entirely of sub shops and beauty parlors, and if you're willing to spend some time in the neighborhood, you can see the entire hairdo ritual from beginning to end. Cruise around until you spot a sour-looking housewife trudging her way to the corner, embarrassed by her deflated, week-old hairdo that no amount of lifting or spraying can disguise. She's in a bad mood because she needs a hairdo and she needs it badly. Watch her as she goes into the sub shop and orders a cheesesteak with everything. An extra mayo, please. Follow her to her favorite beauty shop, but don't get too close. Her hairdo is so stiff that it can cut you on contact. Wait the required several hours and thrill at seeing her emerge victorious, pleased as punch and ready to face the world with her new height. Eastern Avenue is another fertile spot for watching hairdos, and you can usually see women struggling to fit their huge heads into their cars as the wind blows old newspapers and garbage up against them. Bonnie, also known as Mary Vivian Pierce, was once riding on the bus in this neighborhood, and a woman got aboard with such a massive bubble that other passengers laughed in her face. Ignoring them, she sat alone and adjusted the scarf that could barely contain this fresh coiffure. Bonnie watched in amazement as the woman spotted a friend on the street, primped her hair, and yelled out the bus window, "Hey, how do you like this Easter bonnet?" Bonnie said the woman cackled to herself for the rest of the ride. I initially became a hairdo watcher at the height of the teased hair craze in 1962. I liked it when girls' hairdos blocked your view. Waiting at bus stops, I used to like to stand near a do with the sun shining behind it. You could see through the teased web and imagine the torture the girl must go through to comb it out. The Buddy Dean Show, a local version of American Bandstand, is what really turned me into a full-fledged hairdo buff. It came on TV every day after school, and watching it was like being at a hair show. The regular dancers on the show were the first version of stars I knew. Billed as the nicest kids in Baltimore, the boys wore Elvis Presley haircuts, peg pants, and sport coats with belts on the back, and the girls would try to top one another with creative teasing. The most popular girl was Mary Lou, and she was the undisputed hairdo queen. One day it was a double bubble, the next day an airlift. How did that Mary Lou do it? but Pixie was my special favorite. She was not the most popular girl on the show, but to me she was the most outrageous. She was only 4'11", but with Dew she became an easy 5'6". She wore cat-eye makeup, fake cheetah skin dresses, and when she danced, she seemed to lose her balance if she tipped that giant hairdo a little too far to the side. One day, Pixie was absent from the show. Maybe she's sick, I thought, silently wishing her a speedy recovery. But no, Pixie wasn't on the show the next day, or the next day, or the next week, and all the TV watchers began to gossip. "It's not like that Pixie to just leave the show without leading a dance on her last day," her fans whispered. "Something's wrong." Somehow a rumor got started that Pixie was bald-headed and couldn't come back on the show. Supposedly, she never washed her hair, and roaches began nesting in it, feasting on old hairspray, and eventually her hair fell out and wouldn't grow back. I immediately believed it and imagined dancing with her on the show, twirling her around and seeing roach eggs fly out of her hair. Then I heard Pixie was dead and really got upset. "Poor Pixie," I thought, picturing her laid out in her coffin with her bald head pocked with roach bites. So many people believed the rumor that the Buddy Dean show was swamped with sympathy telegrams, and Pixie's mother's home was filled with floral arrangements sent by grieving fans. Pixie agreed to come back on the show for one day to prove she was alive and not bald-headed. She gave interviews to the press and insisted that she was not wearing a wig. Then Pixie quickly vanished back into obscurity, and all attempts to locate her to date have failed. Years later, I was reminded of this story when an actress in one of my films, Anne Marie, told me of a similar but true ordeal she had experienced. It seemed Anne Marie awoke one morning with a violent earache. She tried eardrops, but it seemed nothing would stop the pain. It began hurting so much that she could do nothing but weep, so she made an appointment with an ear doctor. Sitting in his waiting room, still racked with pain, she began to feel a faint stirring coming from the center of her earache. Suddenly, a large roach climbed out of her eardrum, and the pain immediately vanished. Appalled at the thought of roaches living in her ears, but relieved that the pain had stopped, Anne Marie fled the doctor's office, avoiding unnecessary medical bills.